Yeah, in today's session of Applied Mathematical Finance, I'd like to continue talking about calibration of our forward rate model. So we started introducing our very general forward rate model. So actually it's just the forward rate is an Itô process. So like that, we had several more specialized version of this model. So the log normal version, which specifies that there is a special choice here for the coefficient in front of the diffusion. So this is the original version of this model, the LIBOR market model. Or alternatively, if you like to model negative interest rates, a normal version. So then the coefficient here is just a deterministic function, or maybe a little bit better, a displaced log normal version, yeah, like that. And then we started talking about calibration. So calibration, I mentioned, is how do we choose the three parameters, that is initial value. And since we are doing risk neutral valuation, the drift is determined. So, and choice of the covariance matrix. So of the coefficient in front of the diffusion, and if the diffusion has a correlation, this correlation structure. So last session, I talked about the correlation structure. We already talked about the choice of the volatility coefficient, so the sigma, in the sense that we identified which financial product depends on this parameter. We saw the caplet depends, of course, on this, and the swaption depends on this. And when I started talking about this session here, yeah, so I wrote a few remarks on the slides. So first one is what I just said, that calibration is actually inversion of the valuation. So for given values, how do the parameter look like? Yeah, so it is just an inversion problem. So determine the parameters. But calibration also very often is associated with finding an analytic formula. And okay, this reason finding an analytic formula is, of course, this inversion, if you do it numerically, by some root finder, Newton's method, or some optimizer, yeah, some minimization algorithm, then this inversion is actually repeatedly value a financial product and check the distance to the target value. And this repeated valuation, if you perform it with a Monte Carlo simulation, it costs you a lot of time. So you would like to have this fast. So if you perform this inversion numerically, you would like to have the valuation fast. That means you would like to have an analytic formula. So calibration is very closely linked to finding analytic formulas for certain financial products, namely the calibration products, the products to which you calibrate. So finding analytic formulas for certain financial products, assuming the model. So remember that we already derived many analytic formulas. Yeah. So we were looking at the value of a caplet, yeah, under Black models, the value of a caplet under Bachelier model, the value of a swaption under Black model. But these formulas were linked to a certain model. So for each specific application, we thought, okay, maybe that's a nice model because then I can derive and formula nicely. So now I'm not free in choosing the model. The model is given. The model is here our term structure model. And I would like to find now an analytic formula in terms of these parameters here. If I have the special log normal version, then maybe in terms of these parameters. Okay, so that's the program for today. So within the calibration section, I'm now looking at analytic evaluation of certain financial products, caplets, swaptions, or certain properties like a swap rate covariance within this model. So we always start with the forward rate model, and then we try to express the value of the financial product by analytic formulas. And what I will do today is somehow a recipe. So I could start by just stating the theorem and then prove the theorem, but then maybe you don't get the intuition of what's going on. So I do it in the opposite direction. So we will slowly derive certain steps, and in the end, we will reach a certain theorem. Because I would like to give you the intuition how this is done. And it's very often done in the same, yeah, or in a similar way. Okay, so this is a recipe. We will look specifically here or to swaption. So how can you value a swaption within a forward rate model, for example, log normal forward rate model? So this part here is the major part, yeah? So how do you evaluate a swaption assuming a log normal model for the forward rate? So how do you value a swaption assuming a log normal model for the forward rate? And that's just an example because it is a general recipe. Before I look to swaption, yeah, so again here the remark, the reason why we are doing this is that the numerical calculation of the value, for example, here using a full Monte Carlo simulation, is quite time consuming. Yeah, and if you do calibration, and calibration is, for example, here just an optimization, yeah, which requires many of such calculations, then I would like to speed up the valuation. So for Kaplet, it's actually trivial because we already saw that special versions of our model are one-to-one the same model as we had for the evaluation of a Kaplet. For example, if we go back here to our model specification, so the log normal version here, this model is just the same diffusion as we had for the Kaplet. So that was discussed here, black formula for the Kaplet in this section, yeah, the black model for the Kaplet. So if you go back here, the assumption was that we had essentially here a diffusion of this type, and we could derive an analytic formula, namely here black formula for the Kaplet. So the case here, valuing a Kaplet, for example, under a log normal forward rate model is trivial. We already had an analytic formula. Similarly, we can do it for the Bachelier model. So for the Bachelier version for the normal model. Yeah, so if we have the normal model for the forward rate, then we can use Bachelier formula. And if we have the special version that displaced log normal, we can use displaced black formula. Yeah? So there are our shifted black formula. So there are different analytic formulas that are indeed consistent or already there if we have special version of our forward rate model. So this one here is the log normal one. Where is this specified? Okay, so maybe I should add of the log normal. A different thing is if you consider a Kaplet for other forward rates, for example, for forward rates with a longer period. Yeah, so assume that our model, our forward rate model has this tenor discretization, this period discretization, and we would like to look at a caplet on this forward rate. Yeah, so for longer periods here means this forward rate. So this forward rate here, so the forward rate, say LTI to TI plus 2, yeah, so a longer one, is actually, okay, 1 plus, so minus 1, 1 plus LTI to TI plus 2 times TI plus 2 minus TI, so a 1 divided by TI plus 2 minus TI, is the ratio of the zero coupon bond paying at the beginning divided by paying at the end. So this corresponds here to the product I from, so J from I to I plus 1, so the product just over the two periods, so over these two guys here. So this is the product 1 plus LJ, so I didn't specify a time little t, so I can drop this. Okay, so you see a caplet on this is an option on a product of our model primitives. Yeah, so we have a model for this guy. This is our model. And now I would like to value an option on this. So if this quantity here, for example, is log normal distributed, I cannot expect that this one here is log normal distributed. So you see, for caplets on forward rates that have longer periods, actually an analytic approximation of formula is not easily there. Yeah, it's not there, so from what we already had, so we have to work on this, and we can derive such a formula in the same way as we will do it for the swaption. So I will focus on the swaption in the next session, but if you know how to do it for the swaption, you can also solve it here for this case. Yeah, so it is done in the same way as it is done for the swaption. So that was a remark for the caplet. Let's focus now on analytic evaluation of a swaption, assuming a log normal model. So assuming a log normal model for the forward rate. So I'm considering a special case of our model. If that was our general, most general version of the model, I'm now considering this special case. So assuming that we are here under the model 109, the special log normal version, can I derive a value, an analytic formula for the swaption? Okay, so first recall, what is the swaption? What is the swap rate? So a swaption is an option on a swap, but we saw in an earlier session that we can write it as an option on the swap rate. So maximum S minus K, S is the swap rate, and zero multiplied with the swap annuity. So if we go back a little bit to when we defined all these interest rates, we had this little lemma that we can express the swap rate as a convex combination of the forward rates. Yeah? So it looks a little bit as if S is just a linear combination of L, but note that these coefficients here, these are ratios of zero coupon bonds. This here is actually the swap annuity. So these are stochastic. So the relation between the two looks intuitive and simple here, but its true nature is quite complicated. And if this coefficient here would be a constant, would be non-stochastic, then we would have that if L is normal, then S is normal because it is just the sum of normals. But of course, if L is log normal, a sum of log normals is not log normal. But now even it's even more complicated. This coefficient here is something stochastic, and we don't know the distribution of S. Since I do not know the distribution of S, so at this point I don't know an analytic formula. Yeah? So if I would know that S is log normal, I would immediately map it to the Black formula. If I would know that S is normal, I could use Bachelier's formula. But since I don't know this, I don't have an analytic formula. And in many cases, you cannot get exact analytic formula, but you get approximation formulas. So we have to do some approximation step. Okay. And such an approximation step can be derived as follows. So before I move to the next slide, let me sketch you the intuition of what is coming now. So the first question we ask is, do we know some analytic formulas? So I would like to have an analytic formula for a swaption. Yes, we know some analytic formulas. So first thing is you ask yourself, do you know analytic formulas? Yeah, so here answer is yes. Yes, we know them. For example, the Black model or Black formula or Bachelier and so on. Okay, so we had derived this here, the Black model for a swaption, for example. Okay. There was the swap rate. And we assumed that the swap rate was following a log normal process. Another question is then, so what was the underlying? Object or model that we used when we derived this formula. So it was the swap rate. Yeah, so the swap rate S. So when we derived this formula, we were modeling the swap rate. So now the second step is, can we express this swap rate in terms of our forward rates? So express S in terms of the given model primitives. So here, L, yeah? So we have a model for L. We don't have a model for S, we have a model for L. We model L. So DL is, and here I'm looking at the log normal version, yeah? So I'm looking at some DT, depending on the measure, yeah? So I don't care about the measure right now. And then we have LI, sigma I DWI. Okay, so I can express S in terms of the model. So yes, we can do this. For example, the lemma, which I had just shown you, expresses the swap rate in terms of the forward rates. There is this coefficient alpha, but actually you can express the swap rate in terms of zero Cooper bonds, and you can express zero Cooper bonds in terms of forward rates. Yeah? So yes, we can, I believe we can do this. So the next step is easy. Yeah. So you have a model for one quantity L, and you have the other quantity as a function of L. So what do you do? So it's Itô's lemma. So the next step is Itô's lemma. So step three is use Itô's lemma to derive the process for ds. So now there is here a big question mark and some dw. Okay, so how does this look like? And then comes the approximation step. So I know now the dynamic of S, and now try to find an approximation that maps this evolution to the one for which you know the analytic formula. So step four is map this, for example, using some approximation steps, to the model for which you know the analytic formula. Yeah, so the one from step one. So you look, do you know analytic formulas, and you try to map this. Okay, and then you get the analytic formula with some approximated parameters. So Itô's lemma will result in the stuff that appears here is actually a function of these parameters of our forward rate models. You will see this when I do it now, but this is actually a fairly general recipe. Yeah. So very often people go this route in deriving analytic formula under a certain model. And what we do today is just an example. So first thing is we have to recall the definition of the swap rate. So the swap rate is the rate that puts a swap to zero at par. So it is the ratio of the floating leg value. So in our special case, where there is just a single interest rate curve, the floating rate, the floating leg value is the bond that matures at the beginning of the swap minus the bond that matures at the end of the swap, divided by the fixed leg value divided by the fixed rate. So that is the swap annuity. So that is the swap annuity. Okay, so you can recall this here in our definition 141. Yeah, so that was just the definition of the swap rate. My swap is associated with a certain time discretization at which the fixed rate is paid. So this is here the time discretization TI subscript J. So it's possible that the swap here has a slightly coarser time discretization. So if you look here to these guys, yeah, so the swap may have a coarser time discretization. So if this here is the tenor discretization, the period discretization of my forward rates, okay, so it's possible that the swap pays at, say, for example, some coarser discretization. For example, it's often the case that the fixed rate is only paid every year, while the floating rate is paid in a higher frequency. But this is just blowing up a little bit the notation. So I now have here sub-indices that label the periods of the swap. Okay, so that's our swap rate. And you see that the swap rate is given here in terms of zero coupon bonds, yeah, the bond that matures at the beginning of the swap, the bond that matures at the end of the swap. So these guys here are TA, and say here is TB. So I just have a swap with three periods. Okay, and the bonds that mature at the end here of each period, yeah. So this is this guy, and this guy. So the swap rate is given as a function of these zero coupon bonds, all observed at a certain time. So all here observed at little t. Okay, so you see the swap rate is a stochastic process. Yeah, if the zero coupon bond value is a function of the forward rate, yeah, the forward rate is a stochastic process. The swap rate is a stochastic process. So now comes the next step. I know this function. Yeah, so I have not written down the dependency on the forward rate. So maybe I should go back and write this down. Yeah, so you know that every such zero coupon bond here is actually a function of the forward rates. Okay, so this here is the product 1 plus LJ of T delta TJ to the power of minus 1. It runs to K minus 1 and it starts in J equals, okay, so how should I label it now? Can I label it I? Okay. With ti equals to t. Okay, so the little t should be part of my time discretization. Otherwise, there is this short period bond inside. Yeah, so but that is not a big issue now. Actually, we will see that all this stuff will cancel because we have here a ratio of zero coupon bonds, and all the rates that are in the beginning of the product, so all the stuff that is happening here, will cancel out. Yeah? So you have a product of L, a product of L, a product of L, and all the stuff that is before TA will cancel out. So it's actually just a function of the forward rates in between. But I will write down this, I will write this function a bit later, but that's just a remark. So assume now that I have the function that expresses my forward rate, my swap rate, sorry, my swap rate. So that expresses here SA as a function of the forward rates LK. And as I just mentioned, it's only the forward rates that are inside the swap that enter. We can have a look at this again. Yeah, that, but it was also here in this lemma. So if I jump to this lemma that expressed the swap rate as a as a convex combination of the forward rates, then you see it. Yeah, you maybe see it very nicely here in this lemma that it's just a convex combination here of LK. You still have to ensure that these alpha k's here only depend on these LK's, but the same happens here that everything before TA is canceling. Okay, so assume that we have such a function that expresses the swap rate in terms of the forward rates. The forward rates are the ones for which we have the model. So what is the model for the swap rate? Well, that's given by Itô's lemma. So Itô's lemma allows me to write down the stochastic process of a quantity that is the result of a function in terms of the stochastic processes of its arguments. Okay, so the swap rate can be expressed solely in terms of the forward rate, so there's no additional t term, yeah, so there's no dt term here, and I just have the first and second order differentials for here this forward rate. So this is just Itô's lemma, differentiate the swap rate with respect to LK multiplied with DLK. A small remark, there is a little bit of ambiguity in my notation. Yeah. So this guy here is the stochastic process of the swap rate. While this guy here is the function expressing the swap rate in terms of the forward rates. Yeah? So here I'm differentiating a function. So the function expressed the swap rate in terms of LKs. Yeah. So, but I don't want to introduce a different letter for the function like f or a little f or g, yeah, and a different letter for the stochastic process. But there is a bit of ambiguity. So this blue box here just means differentiate this function. So classic differentiation of a function. So to differentiate this function. So we will do this, yeah, we will just differentiate this function. And the same, of course, here, yeah, this is also just the second derivative of a function expressing S in terms of L. As the coefficient of the stochastic process differentials dlk dlj. Well, dlk dlj, lk and lj are Itô processes, yeah, so something dt plus something dw. So you immediately know that dlk dlj is something dt. Okay, so there's no dw in there. So I know that this is something dt. We will see later that I don't care about the dt. I just want to know what is the coefficient sigma dw. The reason is that I perform valuation and I can change the dt by changing the measure. So the dt will not enter into our derivation. And I'm a lazy guy, so I don't write it down. Okay, so I will often use just the dot, 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 dt, yeah, when there is something dt and I don't care what it is. So the interesting part is here, this part. Yeah. This part allows me to express now the process for the swap rate in terms of our process for the forward rates, because here I can now plug in my model. So what we will do there is plug in the model for L. And by this, I get the parameters for L, yeah, the sigma for the L, dwi, sigma I, dwi, the parameters for the Ls. Okay, so These were already some steps. So first step was identify what is the object which I would like to investigate, the swap rate, because I have an analytic formula assuming a model for the swap rate. Second step is, do I know a function of this? Yes, I know a function. Okay, the function will be differentiated later. Next step was use Itos lemma. So now I assume a certain model. So assuming a log normal model for the forward rate. So that was our special version of our forward rate model. So it means that I assume now that dLi is some dt plus Li sigma I dWi. And it can also have a correlation structure here. A small remark here, yeah, because so you don't get confused with the notation. So the sigma I on this slide is the sigma I superscript L, yeah, in number, I believe it was number 108 in our log normal version of the model. So let me just check. No, it was 109. Yeah. So in 109, yeah. So I had here this superscript L. So the superscript L was referring to using a log normal version in 109. Okay. So it's 109. But here in this section, sigma i is the parameter of the log normal model for the forward rate. So I dropped the superscript to ease a little bit the notation. Okay. Well, from the previous slide, so this is here the number 135, I know that I can express ds using Itos lemma, some dt part plus some differentiate the swap rate dlk. Let's go back, differentiate the swap rate with respect to lk, dlk. So here I made already a small transformation step. I multiplied here in front with an S and I divided here with an S. You know? Apart from that, this is just the same as our number 135. Okay, I multiplied with S and I divide by S. Okay, so why am I doing this little transformation? So the thing is, I would like to map now this model to a model for S for which I know an analytic formula. So now this mapping procedure starts. Yeah, this the last step in my my description of the steps. And as you maybe see already here, what I would like to do is I would like to map it to the log normal model for S. So the motivation for this step here. Motivation. We like to write DS as a log normal model so that is DS is I don't care about the DT plus S sigma, and now this is the sigma for S. So maybe I have to have here a different label. So let's call it sigma superscript S DW. Okay, so I would like to have here an S. Here I would like to have something that is deterministic and then some Brownian motions. So let's donate us here this S. And then here this remainder should be something deterministic multiplied with the Brownian motion. Here is a little bit normal, so there should be an R here. So here is a little bit intuition at work. Yeah. So you could also try to map it to the Bachelier model. So don't donate this S. So try to map it to a normal model. And the reason why I now believe that the log normal one would be the best candidate. Yeah, so it's a candidate. We have to later check the approximation. The reason that I would like to map it to a log normal model is this little lemma we had. So let's go back to this little lemma that showed us that we can interpret the swap rate as a convex combination of forward rates with these stochastic coefficients. But if you look at this lemma, then you see you have the following relation. If you have a log normal model for the forward rates, well, I cannot expect that S is like log normal. So you already see that my mapping will be an approximation. But if the model for L is log normal, I know that the interest rates L are positive. So if initial value is positive, they will not become negative. Yeah, so they are positive. So this means that S is also positive because this coefficient here is a ratio of zero Cooper bonds. This is always positive. Yeah? So remark, yeah, from this lemma, if all LK are greater than zero, then the S, in this case, it's Sij, yeah? So in the other slide, it's Sab, will be positive. So for that reason, maybe a log normal model for S is a good model because log normal has the property to become non-negative. This mapping is maybe also nice if you try to do this for the displaced model. If you have a displacement for L, yeah, so what is the lower bound for S? Well, you can then derive maybe a nice displaced model for S. Yeah? Maybe we can do that in some exercise. I cannot do it today. So the motivation why I like to map it to a log normal model here is that S is positive. Yeah. See lemma 142. Okay. So. Large explanation, long explanation for this little step that we donate us here, this SAB. So next step is plug in our model for L. So plug in DLK. So I know that DLK is something DT, so that will just enter here into the DT. And then LK sigma k dwk. So this is plug in the model that we have. Yeah? So plug in here our log normal model. And I would like to have that this is now close to a log normal model for S. So this guy here is nice. Yeah, the sigma is already nice. It is a deterministic function. So here I have S multiplied with a deterministic function with a dw. So there's just this ugly stuff here in front, which is maybe disturbing. And I just define this stuff is wk of t. Yeah. So the wk of t. So what's the wk of t? So the wk is just the stuff inside the sum. Yeah. So I have to be a little bit more precise here, fix this. So this stuff is my wk of t. So wk of t is differentiate the swap rate with respect to the forward rate lk and multiply with lk divide by sab. Yeah. So w is this expression here. Differentiate the swap rate with respect to LK, multiply with LK, divide by SAP. Well, differentiating something and dividing by the something again is differentiating the logarithm, and differentiating with respect to LK and multiplying with LK is differentiating with respect to the logarithm. So maybe you can check this. Yeah, but this is just the same as differentiating the logarithm of SAB with respect to the logarithm of LK. So that's maybe a little bit nicer expression for this W. And you see that the W, unfortunately, this is stochastic. So to some extent, my mapping to the PLEC model for the swap rate failed, yeah, because the PLEC model for the swap rate assumed that the coefficient in front of the dW is of the form S times something deterministic. And here I see clearly this stuff is S times something stochastic. So only if this function here, if this differentiation of the function differentiate the swap rate with respect to L, only if this is deterministic, then the mapping would be perfectly okay. But in general, this is stochastic. Okay, so what can I do? Well, there is an approximation I can do. Before we go to the approximation, let me continue and now assume the mapping would be successful. What is the value that I have to enter into the PLEC formula? So assume that my model for the swap rate would follow here this log normal model. Then you know that you have to plug in the coefficient associated here with this sigma SAB into PLEC formulas. And the coefficient I have to plug in is the average of the variance accumulated over time. So it is the integral of the instantaneous variance. So the instantaneous. So it's the integral over sigma squared. Of the swap rate divided by the time. So that is here the parameter, the PLEC volatility, which I have to enter into the PLEC formula for the swap rate. So if you have this quantity here, I can calculate the value of the swaption using PLEC's formula. So let's go back here. So we did this in this chapter, PLEC model for a swaption. There was the model. That was here our parameter sigma of t. So in this section, there was just labeled sigma, but in my other section, it has to be labeled sigma s, the sigma for the swap rate. And this parameter here, the integral of this, so the sigma bar, the integral enters into PLEC formula. Okay, so how do I get this parameter if I just have the stochastic process for S? So I now have here an expression for the stochastic process. Well, this sigma squared of S dt, well, this is just the quadratic variation. So in our case, since we have a log normal model, I have to divide by S. So let's divide this guy here by S. So then you have something dt sigma dw. And then if you multiply this with ds divided by S again, you have sigma dw multiplied with sigma dw. So you have sigma squared dt. So the integral of this quadratic valuation, well, relative quadratic valuation, so relative, just refers here to the fact that I have to divide by the S. Yeah? The integral of this object is the quantity that I need for the Black formula. Yeah? So the integral of this object. And I have this object in terms of parameters from my forward rate model. Yeah, so that was a small side remark. So what is the object that I need for the analytic evaluation formula? I need this object. So now let's go back to where we were left off here. So the thing is that I need the integral of this object. So this integral of this object involves here integrating these weights, but the weights are stochastic. So what can we do about this? So the quadratic variation using the formula we have derived here is just divide this here by SAB. So if I divide this here by SAB, this guy here will vanish. And then take the square. Yeah. So it is this sum here multiplied with itself. So it is WI sigma I DWI multiplied with WJ sigma J DWJ and the sum over all combinations IJ. That is the quadratic variation, relative quadratic variation of the swap rate using this expression which we have derived. So ds divided by s multiplied with ds divided by s is a sum over all combinations. So I used I and j in my talk. So now here on the slides it's k and l. So a sum over all possible combinations kl from a to b, wk, wl, sigma k, sigma l, dwk, dwl, but dwk, dwl is just rho kl dt. This part here is just the dwk, dwl. And all those parameters are parameters of my forward rate model. Okay, so these guys here parameters of our forward rate model. And the integral from zero to TA of this quantity is the stuff I have to plug in the Black formula to get the value of the swaption. And I have now this stuff in terms of parameters of our forward rate model. It means integrate the covariance here, well, weighted with some weights. And still we have this problem that the weights are stochastic. Well, what do I do? These weights are stochastic processes. I just use the initial value of these stochastic processes as an approximation. So hopefully these stochastic processes don't change too much. Yeah, and I just use the initial value. So this is now the approximation step. So the approximation step to remove the stochasticity from these weights is replace the little t here just for the weights which are stochastic, not for the whole, for all coefficients, just for those where we have something stochastic, replace it by the initial value. So this is here an approximation step. And now on the right-hand side, I have something which is just a deterministic function. Yeah, so with a dt, I integrate it and I get the deterministic value I can work with in the Black formula. No? So this one can then be used in the Black formula. Okay, so you see that if you assume a log normal forward rate model, the swap rate follows a log normal model with a stochastic volatility. Yeah, so it has a stochastic log volatility. So the volatility of the swap rate process is stochastic, and I approximate this coefficient just by its initial value, yeah, to map it to some model for which I have the analytic formula. Of course, I'm not sure if this mapping, if this approximation is too strong, but actually these weights here are how does the swap rate depend on the forward rate? And we already saw the lemma that the swap rate is the convex combination of forward rates. So these weights here, they are just, between 0 and 1, and just telling us what is the percentage of a forward rate contribution to a swap rate. And this property is quite constant. Yeah, it's actually just the length of the period of the forward rate divided by the length of the period of the swap rate. So if we go back to the lemma, that is here our lemma, you see that if the zero coupon bonds here are quite close to one, then actually the weight here, so if this, for example, is 1 and this is 1, then the weight is deterministic, and the weight is just the ratio of the length of the period divided by the whole length of the swap. So if interest rates stay small, this weight here, maybe it doesn't change too much, and this approximation is maybe okay. Okay, so now I can calculate the parameter which I need for the Black swaption formula. So now now we are done. Yeah, so Black swaption formula needs the integral of this stuff. So I'm integrating here from 0 to TA. Well, the parameter is take 1 divided by TA and the square root of that. So there is here a square, and here is 1 divided by TA. So this is the quantity which I need for the Black swaption formula. And since I have approximated by weights, I can move the weights in front of this integral. And you see, it's just integrate the parameter of our forward rate model. So we still have to calculate the weights. Yeah? So I haven't really differentiated this stuff, but assume we know the weights, so then we know here everything, because this is the integrated, so well averaged covariance from the forward rate model. And remember that for here the sigma, we can have functional forms, so then I know the function analytically, and maybe I can calculate this integral here analytically. Or, for example, another possibility was to use piecewise constant function. Then this integral is just a sum, so just sum these piecewise constant contributions. I haven't specified the weights. We still have to calculate the weights. So maybe I like to shorten this here a little bit. So our weight WK was, how does the swap rate depend on the forward rate? So this could be expressed here as differentiate the logarithm of the swap rate with respect to the logarithm of the forward rate. These two logs were just because I was looking at a log normal model for L mapping to a log normal model for S. Yeah? So this is actually just here differentiating. It's the ratio of the two models. Yeah? Also nice intuition. So this is the relevant weight. So it means that differentiate the logarithm of the swap rate. Well, plug in here the definition of the swap rate. So this here is my swap rate. This here is the definition of the swap rate. The bond at the beginning minus the bond at the end of the swap divided by the swap annuity. You can work now the differential inside. So the differential walks here inside. So here, differentiation of the logarithm is 1 divided what's inside. Yeah, so actually the logarithm of ratio is the difference of two logarithms. This is here the first step. Whoops. So first step is the logarithm of a ratio is the difference of two logarithms. Then differentiate these two logarithms here. The differential moves here inside. Differentiation of the logarithm is differentiation of the stuff inside divided by the argument. Okay, and then you see all I have to do is differentiate a zero Cooper bond. So differentiate this zero Cooper bond, differentiate this zero Cooper bond with respect to a forward rate. Yeah. Okay, so the differentiation of the zero Cooper bond with respect to the forward rate is here. Well, it depends if the forward rate is before the maturity of the zero Cooper bond or after the maturity of the zero Cooper bond. Well, if it's after, it doesn't enter at all. If it is before, it enters. And this is differentiate the zero Cooper bond. You can just check this. Yeah, it's easy. Yeah, so the zero Cooper bond is 1 divided by 1 plus L delta L. Yeah? So it is 1 divided by this squared multiplied with delta T. So the 1 divided by squared can be written as the zero Cooper bond multiplied with 1 divided plus L delta T. And there is a minus in front because differentiated 1 divided by is minus 1 divided by squared times the inner derivative. Okay, so that is the differentiation of the zero Cooper bond. And now I plug this in here into these two guys and you get the expression of the weights. So I don't go through this, yeah, because it is just straightforward calculation. But believe me, we can calculate the weights. This is now interpreting the swap rate as a function of L, yeah. So not as a stochastic process, as a function of L. And you see, you can express now this weight, and I can express it in terms of zero Cooper bonds and the forward rate. So I can express it easily in terms of objects which are part of my model. You can simplify a little bit this expression if you introduce the swap annuities, then this expression is for the weights looks like this. Well, you know, I'm a programmer, yeah. I like to implement this in a computer. And such rewritings are important from a computational aspect because this formula can be calculated very efficiently because you see that a lot of stuff can be reused here. And so this here is always the same, yeah. And these here are the annuities which are becoming larger, and the annuity is a sum. Yeah, so this is just an additional step where I add something to a sum. So this is a little bit like what we discussed for the efficient implementation of the drift. So when we have something which is order n squared, sometimes you can make it in the calculation order n, yeah, because it is just an update of a sum. That's just a small remark. So now we are done. So I can summarize now everything in a nice theorem. How do we value a swaption in a log normal forward rate model? So that's here our theorem, analytic approximation of a swaption under a log normal forward rate model. And the approximation is use Black's formula. So use the Black formula for swaption using the Black volatility squared. So this is here the Black volatility squared, where sigma AB squared times TA is this integral of weight K times weight L times sigma k, sigma l, rho k l. But now, and sum over all combinations of k and l. But now I can express this as weight k, weight l, multiplied with this integral of the coefficients of my forward rate model. So this here is the sum over all combinations K and L, weight K, weight L, multiplied with integrate the covariance of the K's and L's forward rate. So a small remark, yeah. So this here is a covariance matrix. So gamma KL, well, bar here is a covariance matrix. And this here is a quadratic form, okay? So this is a quadratic form. So multiply the vector W from left and from right onto the covariance matrix, where the W's are these weights here. And we perform the approximation that we evaluate these weights in zero. So that's a nice theorem, yeah? So you just have to calculate this integral. I already hinted to this interpretation, yeah? So actually this integral that appears here is just the integrated instantaneous covariance of the log forward rates, yeah? So the log coefficient, because we assumed a log normal model. So this is just the covariance matrix. And with this covariance matrix, you can interpret the quantity which we need as a quadratic form. And what is now W? Well, W is the gradient of the logarithm of S with respect to our log LK coordinates. So it's the direction in which S is moving, yeah, in which we have the strongest move in the swap rate. Yeah? So you see that this is just the covariance of the swap rate multiplied from left and right with the gradient. How does the swap rate change if the forward rate changes? It's a quite intuitive thing, yeah? So we map covariance from forward rate to variance of swap rate. It's a general recipe, and the only thing is that we had this approximation here that our coefficient in this quadratic form was stochastic, so we approximated it with something deterministic. So this is the approximation. The approximation we did is that we approximated these weights. Sometimes in the literature, you find this under the name freezing of drift. Yeah, this is because actually this here, this dependency can be interpreted as a drift. The weights also occur in the drift of S. But really, I find this a bit misleading, because what we did is we approximated a stochastic volatility coefficient by a deterministic volatility coefficient. So actually, it is a little bit like freezing off stochastic volatility. So I like to do the same now for the normal model. So what happens if we assume a normal model for the swap rate, for the forward rate? And I will do this very quickly, because I already told you what you have seen now was a general recipe. So you always do it like these, in maybe with small modifications. So now we can do it very quickly. So we assume a normal model. So assuming a normal model means that here I have this coefficient sigma I dwi for the forward rate. So again, here, the sigma I is the parameter sigma I n when we specified the special version of this model. Yeah? So I don't use the superscript. And now I like to map this to a model for the swap rate. Maybe I use a normal model for the swap rate. Yeah? So I like to map this map it to a normal model. For S, yeah, so for SAB. So that means I would like to apply then Bachelier formula for the swap rate. And you see that these steps are just the same. So there is no this additional S term, which I donated here in front, so it's missing. And there's no additional L term missing here. So the multiply with S and divide, so the multiply with L and divide by S is missing. So now my weight here is a different weight. So the weight here is differentiate not the logarithm of S with respect to L, the weight is differentiate S with respect to L. Well, quite intuitive, yeah? So I like to map a normal model of L to a normal model of S, so I differentiate S with respect to just L. So this here is now my weight. So the weight is now the normal weight. It's a different weight. Yeah? Previously, we had the log normal weight is differentiate the logarithm of S with respect to the logarithm of L. Well, you know that this is actually the same as differentiate S with respect to L, multiply with L divided by S. So you see that there's a relation between the weights. Yeah. So you see that this is just my normal weight multiplied with L divided by S. So the weights, I don't have to calculate the weights again. The weights are just the same and multiply with S divided by L. Okay, so next step is I like to map this to a normal model for the swap rate. So my swap rate dynamic looks like this. The stuff that I need for the Bachelier formula is just the integral of this parameter. This is just the integral of the quadratic variation. So the same argument, the integral of the quadratic variation. So I integrate this guy here. But instead of integrating this guy, I can also integrate ds ds. So now I go back and calculate ds ds in terms of my derived parameters, yeah, from Itô's lemma. So we get that ds ds is actually the sum of the weight sigma k, sigma l, rho k l. Now these are all the normal parameters. So my approximation is again the same. The approximation is these guys here are stochastic. So approximate them with the initial value and you can calculate the integral. Now, just the same steps. And you saw very small modifications. I use a different input dynamic for L and I map it to a different model for S and I need to approximate a little bit the coefficients. The weights are given by that, and this is just the same formula where I divided by L and multiplied by S. So the only change is here, this little guy here. Yeah, so derivation of the weights is the same. So you can write down the weights explicitly, also with the annuity, and we are done. So I have 3 more minutes, so I like to show you one last aspect, namely, so now we have an analytic formula, and how can you efficiently implement this formula? Let's go back. Maybe to this interpretation. And when you do object-oriented design or implementation, it's very good that you are a mathematician because you have to ask yourself, okay, where does this thing belong to? So you see what we have to calculate is a covariance matrix. So we have to calculate this guy here. Then we have to calculate the weights. And we have to calculate this quadratic form. So they are 3 part. So actually the covariance matrix should belong to the model. For example, if you have a functional form in sigma, you can calculate this covariance matrix analytically. So this maybe is a property of the model. Well, the weights is the dependency of S on the forward rate. Well, you might also say that this is part of the model because you need to know the quantities of the model to evaluate it. But look that this depends here on the AB. So this depends on the specific swaption I'm looking at. So this is a property of the product. And this is important if you have many different swaptions calculated against the same model. So then you can reuse this covariance matrix for different financial products. So I like to reuse calculation. So this guy has to be calculated again and again if the model parameters changes. But this guy is actually, so if the sigma parameter changes, so assume the initial value stays the same, but this guy here is actually the same for each product. So this guy can be pre-calculated in the product. This guy can be pre-calculated in the model. And then this here is part of the valuation code. Yeah, so the valuation code is asking the model, what is your covariance matrix? The valuation code of the product knows which swaption it should look at and calculates the weights, and then it's calculating this. And to conclude, you can have a look at how this is done. So in our large library, there is here a section on Monte Carlo models, interest rate models, products, and there are different versions. There is here a generalized analytic approximation. This can do normal model, log normal model, and there is a not so generalized one. Yeah, and here's another one. Let's have a look at this one. This is just the log normal one. So this one is just the log normal one. So you see here the approximation is differentiate the logarithm of S with respect to the logarithm of L. This is the weight. And let's have a look at this valuation code. So the valuation code of this guy here is comparatively short. Yeah? It goes from here to here. Yeah? So it's comparatively short. And it's just doing what I mentioned in the implementation. It is asking the model, please give me your covariance matrix. So model, please calculate the covariance matrix. And the model is using a cache and calculates this only if it has changed. And all financial products can use this covariance model. And then it's calculating this integral using the weights. So here are the weights. And the weights, so the log weights here, are calculated here in this financial product in the small helper function. So this is the small helper function here, which calculates the weights. So this is a bit lengthy. So it pre-calculates the annuity and this stuff. And it's just the formula which was on the slide. So you maybe can have a look at this implementation. So this is the implementation of this analytic formula, and you can maybe check how good this formula is compared to the true Monte Carlo formula. So when we have calculated the weights, we calculated this integral, then we have the integrated swap variance. So from that, we take the square root. So we take divide by t and the square root, and we plug then in this volatility into the Black-Scholes formula. That's it. So not lengthy, but of course here the model has to calculate the integral of the covariance matrix depending on which form you use. So that was a small remark. On the implementation, which you also find here in the script. So a small tip on the efficient implementation, where there are two observations for this. two observations. So the first thing is that the weights can be calculated once because they only depend on the product, yeah, and the integrated covariance of the log forward ratios needs to calculate only once per iteration. So whenever the parameter changes, because all products depend on this matrix. That's it for today.